dog to hear from somebody else, because I don't expect they'll get it. Now, let me say this, you might not feel that end time teaching is important to you.
Yes, it is, it's very important.
But everything that we're seeing today has been fulfilled, all of the signs been fulfilled that were predicted, are things that we need to watch. Bible said, watch and pray. Yes, watch these things come to pass, and the closer the Lord's coming comes, then the more you're gonna see all of these things taking place at the same time. That's how you know that you have to do it, because all of these things we spoke of will be taking place at the same time. And one of the things that you really want to do, last Sunday I talked about rapture readiness. I'm going to do a lot of things that's going to be focused on end time teaching, and one thing I'm going to do with the rapture readiness, I'm going to do a lesson on that to show you that all of those people, all of those heroes of faith, people that inherited the promise, and people that God talked about and He commended, we need to look at their life.
Is your mic on?
And we need to see exactly what made them pleasing to God. Because what happens, if you look at the patriarch, the prophet, the Bible says these were men who faith and patience inherited the promise. These were people that will have an abundant entry into the kingdom. They will be resurrected, but they will have an abundant entry into the kingdom. That means, you know, God will say, well done, thy what? Good and what? Faithful service. You'll have some people with an average entry into the kingdom. They just did enough to show that they were trying and to make it in. And then you'll have some people that will barely get in. But they'll get in by the skin of their teeth, and then you'll have others that won't make it, period. Faith without works is dead, so people that don't have works that will accompany their faith, you know, they just won't make it. There's got to be some works in order for us to. That's the reason why we are here. That's the purpose that God has called us. And we want to make sure that our works are going to be pleasing to God. And I tell you, probably, we might need to study this pretty carefully, and I think that we could study the heroes of faith, men that we knew that were in good standing with the Lord, and those that ran their course, they fulfilled their purpose, and when they passed on, God classed them as those that, like Caleb and Joshua, these were men that, how does the Bible characterize these two men?
They're holy.
They're holy, please the Lord. W-H-O-L-L-Y. They were holy. So that's the kind of record we want to have. Paul said, I fought a good fight, and I had to finish my course, and I'm ready to go for that. But I think that, you know, when you study all of these men, there were outstanding virtues that accompanied them. And what happens is that God said pleasing things about them, and God validated them, and basically, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Now, if you want to see how we stand today with the Lord, you can kind of judge God's attitude toward us by the seven churches in Revelation 1, Revelation 2 and 3. That would be good to study. For instance, the first church was the best, was the church that Paul helped to discover. They started out good, they had a good foundation, and they had the whole gospel preached to them. They were all fine, they really loved the Lord. But at the close of that era, what the Lord says that, he pointed out the good things about them, a lot of things good about them. So they were people that endured tribulation and went through stuff real well. They were people that believed in holiness. They were people that they were able to judge the true prophets and apostles from the false people. And they had a whole lot of good qualities, but the Lord said, I got one thing against you, and the one thing that I have against you is that you have left your first love. And he said, repent, and the first one's all over again. If you don't, then I'll come in and I'll remove the candlestick. That meant that his presence would be removed from that. The end result of that church was that most of them didn't repent, and the few that heeded the message, they were the ones that were able to carry the knowledge of God and the anointing of God, the Spirit of God, over into the next era, which was the era in which the church was severely persecuted. And he had good things to say about that church because they had gone through the fire, you know, they had been martyred and thrown to the lions, and they had, so they thrown in bags with scorpions and snakes and threw in the river. They had made to walk on hot coals. I mean, a whole lot of things they went through because they had a whole lot of cruel emperors. But the Lord said that, be faithful. He said, I see your sufferings and your patience and your tribulations, and be faithful unto death, and I'll give you a crown of life. So if you went through all of these churches, you would see the things that were lacking in their midst, and you can see that the same things exist today in the church. And God did not give in one iota and let them die because they were... they had a whole lot of good qualities, but the Lord said that the main thing, it seems like the Lord really wants, he wants us to, whatever we do, whatever lifestyle we live, whatever we confess, he wants us to maintain the vibrancy, the anointing, and the fervor and the zeal that we started out with. So lukewarm and doing things because we know how to do them and not being totally for God in our hearts is what God calls you've lost your first love. Get back, start doing the first works over and maintaining the love that we initially had as believers. And also, you might want to look at the love that the apostles had initially in the book of Acts. That's the standard, really. So we got something to shoot for, and we don't want to be complacent because I said, we come to church, we come to Sunday school, we come to Bible study, and we could, still be void of our first love. And that sense of need, that thing that makes you get up in the morning and seek the Lord, and things that make you fast and pray when the pastor doesn't call to fast. And all of the people that show up on Sunday, We really, well, this is a test. What do you care about people that's not saved and that show up, you know, that sometimes we meet them and sometimes we don't. Sometimes we don't do anything to try to help to get them, you know, where we are in the position where they can receive. And I think about things like that all the time, that because that is a sign of your first love, and you really have a real intense desire to help people, to bless people, and to be that person that will walk along with them to really help them to receive what they need to receive from the Lord. So for that reason, I think that, you know, getting back to special times that all of us can come together and really begin to unite our efforts together in prayer and seeking the Lord, and above all, is trying to get an understanding of what the will of the Lord is, especially the things that we're studying now. That's the test of real love and hunger and a sense of need and a desire to really get in a position where God will be totally pleased with us. Okay. Yeah, you know, the losing your first love is more than likely you're still going to be doing everything that you've always done, but you just don't have the zeal, the push, the commitment, that brokenness. And, okay, let me just give you an example. This, you know, is true of all of us. Like on Sunday, when you have all of these people that need to be saved and some of them need to be filled with the Holy Spirit, they really need prayers. Most of them got really, really difficult problems, and the spirit of prayer is the only thing that anointing is the only thing that can break through and get these people maybe weeping or broken or having the desire to come down to seek the Lord. And even when they come, sometimes we can have an altar full of people, and many times we don't have that much desire to even pray in the spirit. And y'all heard me say, y'all, please pray in the Spirit. Please pray. You know, so people can get a little, you know, if we don't pray in the Spirit, I mean, they're not going to get no breakthrough, more than likely. The atmosphere is not going to be where they can really receive. The anointed is the thing that breaks the yoke. And many times, I get the impression, maybe I'm wrong, I hope I am, that y'all say, leave me alone, I don't want to be praying in the Spirit. What good is that going to do? It's time to go home. You know, that's the way I feel sometimes. But that is very important for us to understand that when Zion travail, sons and daughters are born. And Paul said, I travail in birth until Christ is born in you. So Paul was a person that wept and cried and travailed for saints until they were established in the Lord. And that's the reason why he said, I pray the Spirit more than all of you, because much of his praying was in the Spirit. And when we don't have a desire to do that, when you feel like your leader or your pastor is pushing you to do something that you don't feel like you need to do, a lot of times people feel that they know more than I do. I don't need this. You know, I don't need to be praying in the Spirit. And some of y'all just look at me when I said pray in the Spirit, you just be looking. And these people up here, you know, at the brink of eternity, you know, without the Lord. And that's what I'm speaking about, losing. You know, you lose that without even thinking that you've lost it. I mean, you don't even think you're lost. You think you're as good as I've always been. But most of us know that we are not as fervent and really committed. So that's the thing that we want to revive. I've been thinking about what we can do. And I think that it's got to start with the information that we're doing now. Unless you see where we are and what condition we are in, and we understand those letters Paul wrote to the church, so you can see what God really hates. And he, you know, I mean, he had some detestable things to say about it. And everybody felt like, you know, well, you know, I'm just as good as Paul, you know, they probably were carrying out their responsibilities in the same manner. Nothing had changed, but they just wasn't doing it with what? With that brokenness and that real hunger and that dependency on the Lord, because a lot of things can take that away. Just your everyday routines and cares of life and all of the things that we have to go through and do, that just will zap it. So that's the reason why it's important that saints come together sometime and fast and pray and get that brokenness restored. And that's something that I've been thinking about. Maybe we can do that after we get a handle on the times, the nearness and the closeness of the coming of the Lord. I think that when this dawns on you, when this end time teaching dawns on you, I think that would be kind of like a wake-up call for you. But it's very difficult for me to create that hunger or that desire for you to really come to a point where you see that I've got to come up and I've got to find out where I am with God, and I really want to do all that I can. I can't really do that other than just admonish you to study the Word. Now, if you have been motivated to fill these lessons out, that's a good sign that you are a long ways off. Because if you don't get hold to something that's designed to wake you up just before Jesus comes, it's going to be very difficult for you to pull yourself up by your own bootstraps. Like this teaching, this is when revival. The dark ages, how many of the dark ages when the gospel just lost out? Nobody, everybody would start teaching the heretical stuff, the error. That went on for about 1,000 years. It was just a few people that just stayed true to God that was responsible for the Reformation that brought back the teachings that they started off with in the book of Acts. And guess what teaching that really helped to bring the awakening? The main teaching was the coming of Christ, the end time teaching. That was the teaching that really got people kind of back on track. And that was when the Bibles were printed and then it made it possible for everybody to have a Bible. And then people began to understand that the coming of the Lord is something that everybody got to what? Prepare for and get ready for. So I'm all for what I'm thinking about, going over these exercises and breaking y'all down into groups so that y'all can understand it better. And then maybe at the end of the month, maybe have a week, Friday night, and we might have a Sunday evening as well, that we will let y'all get these lessons over to a lot of them that don't even come, about half of the congregation or more than half. They're not even with us, really, in terms of the teaching on Wednesday night. And so that's the problem we're dealing with. Unless we can do something to get them hooked in, but everybody that don't come got some type of excuse. The new ones don't. At this point, they don't, they're not motivated because they probably don't have a good enough grasp on this kind of teaching. But it's just something that sometimes just kind of concerns me, because I know if Jesus came right now, if Jesus came real, like some of them we think, which he is, then it's going to be a lot of problems. Okay, so we want to revive the fasting and the prayer. We want to revive brokenness. We want to revive a real hunger and a desire to help people. We got 25 or 30 people that have been in here the last few months. And we just got to get a few people that will be willing to pray and to hook up with more of them and to really help to pray them through and that can be done on Monday nights, you know, but not without really admonishing them and building relationships with them. If we announce all new members come on Monday night to get, to have prayer, to receive the Holy Spirit or whatever, it wouldn't more than likely come. But that would be a good time if we could have a, if, you know, commitment to reach out to them, and we can set some Monday nights that we specifically pray for them, and Friday nights that we can just pray for new members to get filled with the Holy Spirit. So that's the type of thing that we really got to do, and I want to try to get moving in that direction in the month of February, and we're going to set a weekend that we can maybe, 1 week that we can work with new members during prayer times, and even maybe we can set a Friday night that we'll spend some quality time recapturing some of these truths, let y'all do it rather than me, and then pray for a breakthrough so that we can really experience brokenness. How many remember the brokenness that we used to, you know, we used to pray the Spirit, I can devote with praise and worship? I mean, we could even have preaching. People be weeping and crying and coming to the altar of their own. I can't make all of that happen by myself. But doing what we're doing now is a step in that direction, provided if you are taking this serious and reading your material and working out the questions and answers. So that's what I feel that we have to do, because I want to do some teaching on a lot of areas. The judgment seat of Christ. We want to do all the judgments that will take place, the judgments of the Gentile, the judgments of the Israel, the nation of Israel. We want to do millennium teaching. We want to do tribulation teaching. And also we want to do a lot of teaching on being prepared. And, you know, this is teaching like I'm trying to get into it now in terms of showing the things that the Lord clearly has told us that he wants us to do in order to be counted worthy, to be accounted worthy of his blessing, I mean, his entry into the kingdom. Okay, let's do questions from part one, part two. Questions from part one. This is the true and false, two comings of the Lord explained, part one. I guess we have how many exercises in there? 20-something? 25, right. Two comings of the Lord, true and false. That's what we talked about before, right? Okay, I'm not going over that teaching because the teachings are something that you have to read and do the questions and answers from. I'm telling you, you're making a serious mistake if you don't think what I'm doing now is serious. You're making a real mistake, because there's nothing that can awaken you and get you thinking towards the imminent coming of the Lord except teachings that's going to be dealing with that. So if you're not working your lessons out, if you're not taking this serious, you're on the wrong track. Okay, Sister Mary.
I was wanting to know if we could start on page 12 and then go to the false.
Okay, page 12, okay.
I had a hard time with it. I'm beginning to get it.
Okay, page 12, okay. Okay, let's see what page 12 talks about. Okay, now 12, you'll be talking about the questions or what?
Yes, questions.
Okay, now which question?
1 through 11, I
want to
make sure I got
them
right.
Okay, will all men who died be ultimately raised from the dead, okay?
I said yes.
Yes, everybody that worked that out. since Mary was concerned about those. Who's the first person to be raised from the dead?
Jesus.
Okay. When it says first person raised from the dead, you know, Lazarus was raised from the dead. And you have people. He wasn't the first? Okay. All right. Jesus was the first one to receive immortality, or that was a raised incorruptible, receive a glorified body. See, everybody, I mean, he's the first one that was raised from the dead and did that.
What do you call that?
No more.
When the grave opened up, the saints or something.
Okay. Yeah, that was
not a resurrection.
Yeah, those were raised after Jesus. Jesus was raised first, because if Jesus hadn't been raised, then they would have thought he's the resurrection.
Was that,
right.
Was that a resurrection, or was it a rapture?
That's
yeah.
Resurrection.
Yeah. Yeah, it was a resurrection from the dead, and also they were caught up, so it was, you know, like a rapture. Okay, number three, explain the resurrection mentioned in Matthew 27, 52, 53.
Is that where a few Old Testament saints were raised?
Mm-hmm, that was a handful of what we call them first fruits of them that slept. They were raised along with Christ. So that's basically what number three. Describe your resurrection of the church. 1 Corinthians 15, 1 Thessalonians 4. All of those describe, it says that Christ shall descend with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and the dead in Christ shall what? Rise. And those that are living will be what? Changed in the moment, in the twinkling of an eye. So you have to go to those scriptures that dealt with the rapture. 1 Corinthians 51 through 54, I believe. 1 Thessalonians 4:16 through 18 and 19. Those would be the scriptures that deal with the rapture, which only Paul had a revelation of that. Nobody else did. All right, number five, what evidence supports the conclusion that the resurrection of Old Testament saints will occur at the time of the second coming of Christ to the earth? That was found in your little paper pamphlet. Let me see. I'll show you that where that is. Somebody tell me what the rapture of
the Old Testament.
Is that the rapture? That's page 10.
The resurrection
of what? The Old Testament. Mm-hmm. I'll
go
over that quickly.
It's page 10.
Okay. Okay, the resurrection of the Old Testament saints. Okay. Okay. All right. Now, Job 19:26. That's what Job says. That's the only way that you can tell about the resurrection of the Old Testament saints is God speaking through those old patriarchs and prophets. And Job 19:25-26, somebody just turned there, I'll just show you how you connect that with the second coming of Christ. Somebody just read that for me. Job speaking about when the Son of Man shall stand in the latter day upon the earth. In the next sentence, he says that though skin, even though after my
skin worms
have destroyed my body, yet in my
flesh
I shall what?
See God.
So he was connecting when Jesus came back to the earth on the latter day. He was connecting that's when his flesh would be what? Raised and resurrected. And he will see the Lord. So he connected the coming of the Lord to the earth. So, you know, that's what he said, that when the Lord stands on the earth in the latter day. So he was connecting the second coming. See, God deals with Old Testament saints differently than he deals with the church. Everything is going to be different. See, the church period where God will resurrect him, for the most part, the church would be the rapture. That's what we expect in that. That's when the church. That's from Pentecost to the rapture. That's when they will be resurrected. The Old Testament saints will be resurrected, not with the saints, according to all of these references here, but they will be resurrected at the end of the what? Tribulation period, when the Lord comes back and stands on the earth. That's when that resurrection, just before the Lord comes back. They're going to be judged. So, and they're going to be part of the army that comes back with the Lord. So it's going to be right at the close of the tribulation period. That's when the saints, okay, let me give you another illustration. Daniel 12, 1 and 2. Now, it's kind of important for you to understand how God is going to deal with people in different dispensations. Everybody's not going to even be his bride. Okay, Daniel 1, Daniel 12, 1 and 2. Somebody read that one for me.
And at that time shall Michael say the great prince was standing for the children of thy people.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone that shall be found written in the book, and many of them that sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, and some to the shame of everlasting death.
Okay. That's Daniel 12:1. Okay, that time shall Michael stand up, the great prince which standeth for the children of our people. So that takes place halfway the tribulation period, when Michael gets involved with Israel again. That's when all that persecution is going to be heralded by the Antichrist, when the Antichrist is going to be forcing people to take the mark of the beast, and millions of people are going to be killed, Gentiles and Jews that receive Christ during that period of time. And the Lord is going to Michael is going to be the one that's going to intervene to keep the Antichrist and all of the hostility of the Antichrist kingdom from completely eradicating or destroying all of the Jews. So this is speaking about the last half of the tribulation period. And he says, and there shall be a time of trouble, speaking about the tribulation. So you really want to know about the tribulation period too. So it's going to take some time for us to get through all of that. Such as never was since there was a nation, even to that same time. And at that time, our people shall be delivered. Okay? The deliverance is going to come through when Christ will come back to deliver Israel from complete annihilation. And most of Israel would have fled from there. A lot of them would have fled. Many of them would have gotten killed. And the Bible says that when Christ comes back to the earth, only he's going to regather all of the Israelites from all nations, and then they're going to be judged. And that's going to be right at the close of the tribulation period, and everyone that shall be found written in the book. That's when people that have been beheaded, people that back for their testimony during the tribulation, they're going to be resurrected. That's when all of the martyred dead will be resurrected at that particular point. Everybody's name that was found in the book of life will be resurrected. Now, we know that, let's look at verse 2. And many of them that sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake. That's going to be the Old Testament saints will awake. That's going to be all of those martyrs during the tribulation period that were killed. That's when they will be resurrected. But the unsaved dead won't be resurrected until 1,000 years later. That's going to be at the white throne judgment when they will be resurrected. So he kind of put both of them in the same verse. And many of them that sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, and some to shame and everlasting contempt. But those that will be raised to shame and everlasting contempt will take place about 1,000 years later. All right, so that takes care of that. All right, and now the Isaiah 26:19. Y'all learning a little something now. I guess it's going to something else. I don't know how did that work. How did that relate to me? Okay, Brother Sam.
Okay, you said 1,000 years, if I still, that's going to relate to the years that it is today, or it's going to be like a quick time?
Yeah, it's going to be 1,000 years. That's the, during the millennium. The saints the unsaved dead will be raised at the close of the millennium. So that will be 1,000 years during the millennium. Saints, everybody that comes into the millennium will be saved. People are converted.
It will be years like we have now are different.
Yeah, it won't be 1,000 years like the one day with the Lord.
No.
It's going to be a literal 1,000 years. And the Bible even speaks, if you read the millennium, the resurrection of the millennium saints, you see that the lifespan of people will be what? Restored. And people will actually live probably close to 1,000 years. Yes, some will probably die, and those that commit sin are going to die.
That's a long time to live.
But you're going to be preserved, and you're going to have a tree of life. You're going to have all of the things that we started out with restored. You know, a lot of that peace with the veil. And we're going to talk about the millennium. That's going to be a whole teaching by itself. Well, what can you? That's what the Lord does, you know.
Yeah, I know, but
Moses was with the Lord 40 days and 40 nights. He neither ate nor drank.
Yeah, it's true.
Okay.
But I'm thinking of 1,000.
Well, they did it. Adam, a Methuselah.
I'm not disputing it. But
see, all of the things that cause people to age and deteriorate, that won't be enforced. Like the ozone layers getting thin.
Yeah, and I guess you'll have a kind of a different mindset too.
Evil will be extinguished.
Yeah, I mean, just like, you know, well, like you hear some people like in their 80s and 90s and near 100, you hear them say, well, I'll live long enough, I'm ready to go home.
Right.
To be with the Lord, you know.
Well, they're full of aches and pains, but your body, the glorified body gonna handle aches and pains. And those that come directly into the millennium in their physical bodies, then they'll be eaten from the tree of life. Tree of life is the thing that creates immortality. That's the reason why Adam was driven out of that. Because if he had eaten of that tree, he never would have died. And he never would have gotten sick and probably never would have aged. See, everybody that's glorified, when Jesus comes, the Bible seems to teach that everybody will be like like a 33 years old, the age that Jesus was. We're going to be like him. We're going to see him as he is. So we won't be, nobody should be older than 33.
Won't be
no decrepit. Everything will be restored. Everything that was deteriorating and teeth will be restored, hair will be restored, you'll be the prime of your youth.
And the mind too.
Mind too.
You have a different mindset.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because, you know, you really will have a different mindset. Because the minds that we have now,
eyes will be restored too. Eyes,
Yes, I have this agreement with her. That's what the rapture's all about, is changing you from mortal to immortality. That means that death has no more power, sickness, and all of the things that cause us to deteriorate.
That's why the second death has no more power.
Right, the second death has no power over those that are resurrected, first resurrection. The bunch won't have, death won't have no power.
Will the angels get bodies? Or they'll stay as angels?
Angels won't get no bodies. They'll keep what they got.
They'll keep ministering.
They'll keep ministering and doing what they do. All right, so the very end, let me get on. Okay, Isaiah 26. We'll see.
Number 6.
Okay, go ahead and read that real quick. Isaiah 26, 19 through 21. That's another. See, all of these scriptures are showing that Old Testament saints are going to be raptured or resurrected right at the close of the tribulation period, as it's all connected to the second coming of the Lord to the earth. Okay, Isaiah 26, 19 through 21. All right, I'm blessed that Mary Ann has some problems with this because y'all get it explained to you. Yeah, somebody read that from Isaiah 26, 19 through 21.
The dead man should live together with any dead body. They arise, awake, and sing. Ye should dwell in the dust, for the dew is as the dew of herbs, and the earth should cast out the dead. Come up, is it just 25 or
26?
Come, my people, enter thou into thy chambers, and shut thy doors about thee. Hide thyself, if it were for a little moment, until the enemy. The old past. For behold, the Lord cometh out of his place to punish the inhabitants of the earth for their iniquity. The earth also should disclose her blood and should no more cover her slain.
Okay. So you can say that scripture is referring to the tribulation period, where it says that come my people, enter back into my chamber. Actually, during that period of time, there are going to be a whole, for instance, there will be a lot of people that God will protect, and they will, the Bible mentions about, Jesus told them to flee into the mountains, if you're in Judea, flee into the mountains, that's when the wrath of the Antichrist will be raging, and he told them when that happened, for them to what, flee up into the mountains. So many will flee into cities and countries surrounding Israel for protection. And that's going to be during the Great Tribulation period. So this is referring to the period in which the wrath of the Antichrist will be raging, and God has some protection for many of his people. And he says, for behold, the Lord cometh out of his place to punish the inhabitants of the earth for their iniquity. So that's the Lord coming back with his saints. That's when he's going to punish the inhabitants of the earth. So we can see that in this particular passage, it's referring to the resurrection of the Old Testament saints being connected with the coming of the Lord to the earth to punish the inhabitants of the earth. So in every case, and we just read, the resurrection of Old Testament saints is connected with the coming of the Lord back to the earth to punish, to put down the Antichrist, to punish the nations, and so forth and so on. And also Christ is going to judge the Gentile nations. He's going to judge Israel. All of that's going to take place when he comes back. He's going to judge the nation Israel. And some of them are going to be encouraged to come into the kingdom, and others are going to be cast into everlasting punishment. And the same thing for the Gentile, the sheep and the goats. That's the judgment of the Gentile nations. And those that pass the judgment, they're going to go into the kingdom alive. That's how God determined to populate the kingdom during the millennium period. It's going to be millions of people in the kingdom during the millennium period. So it will be Gentiles and Jews in their natural bodies, and everybody else will have glorified bodies that resurrected and raptured. Resurrected and raptured. That means all the saints, all the Old Testament saints, they will be raptured and glorified bodies, and they will be. They'll have it on the nations. So we're going to, you know, rule and reign with Christ. So we're going to execute a whole lot of power.
So will the saints that are in their natural body, recognize the glorified
body? Mm-hmm. Everybody will recognize one another. There won't be no difference in the way you look now. I mean, you know, basically, when you were in your prayer, when you were in your prayer, when you were and people will have the prerogative. Some of them will be sinning. That's the reason we're going to have a lot of jobs. They're going to have to be ministered to. They're going to have to be taught the word. You know, all these people just coming into the kingdom, they're going to have to be taught. You'll be in heaven in Jerusalem, brother. You'll be flying around. Appear and disappear.
Would you be able to recognize that I have a glorified body if I'm going to look just like I look now? You know, could a person that does not have a glorified body recognize a person with it if you still look the same?
Mm-hmm. The Bible says you will be known even as you're known.
Jesus went through that.
Everybody was able to recognize him. That's the best example we can give.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But now his disciples didn't recognize him at first when he resurrected.
Well, they just didn't believe that was possible for him to be alive because they didn't work. They were buried. When their eyes rolled open, then they recognized him. Mm-hmm. Okay, Sister Mary, let me see what else. What else you had some problems with? Number six. What does the scripture reveal about the resurrection of tribulation saints?
Are these the gleanings?
Okay. The Bible will reveal that the tribulation saints are going to what? They're going to be resurrected. That's the only thing I know the scripture reveal about.
Are these the ones that don't take the mark of the beast and they're considered the gleanings and they got to be added to the main rapture?
Yeah, the gleanings during the tribulation period are those that were preached the gospel during the tribulation period by the 144,000. Those that had the seal of God in their foreheads, through God protecting them throughout the tribulation. They are incapable of dying, those with the seal of God in their forehead. Those just 144, but they were responsible for 144,000, but they were responsible for Revelation 7, a great multitude that nobody could number, and from all nations, kindred, and tongues. So there's going to be a whole bunch of people that's going to be saved during the tribulation period, and these are going to be all of the people that were saved during the tribulation period are going to be the end ones. The incoming, the end ones, these are the gleanings. That's the last bunch, last company, the last troop. They're going to be gathered in at the close of the tribulation period. And they're going to have to make up that army that comes back with Christ when he comes back to punish, to destroy the Antichrist, and to mete out, execute judgment on the ungodly.
Okay.
Okay.
So number seven, yes.
Will saints die in the millennium period? Yes, if you die, you'll be cut off right then. I mean, if you sin, though. What will happen to the living saints at the end of the millennial kingdom? What will happen to the living saints at the end of the millennial kingdom?
They'll be raptured or taken from the earth without dying in the same fashion Christ was raptured.
Okay, is that what you said? Yeah.
That's what I said.
Okay, well, that's the answer. Agree to give them the variance.
They will be raptured or taken from the earth without dying in the same fashion the church is raptured, on page 11.
Right. See, resurrection means that you have to, resurrection or rapture. It's the same difference. If you're still living, you'll be raptured. If you're dead, you'll be what? Resurrected. So it's going to be a resurrection because some saints are going to what? Die. And then some will be what? Living. So it will be a resurrection of the dead and it will be a rapture after the resurrection. Along with it, whatever. Okay? All right, describe the resurrection of the wicked dead. All right, anybody want to describe that? Okay, the resurrection of the, they will be resurrected in the same manner that everybody is, but the only thing, their bodies are going to bear the mark of whatever sickness or disease or deterioration or whatever. Yeah, it won't be, their bodies won't be changed like ours. If they're 80 or 90, they'll still be that age.
They won't have
glorified bodies. And then they will be caught up, I guess, write their own judgment, and they will be sentenced to the lake of fire, cast into the lake of fire. The Bible describes it pretty vividly in Revelation 21, I believe. All liars, and give you a list of everybody that's going to be in that particular category. Wait, pardon?
People will be born during that period of
the millennium. Yeah, during the period of the people will be born. It will be a real live nation of people. They don't have to live and die or get saved and all of that. So it's going to be a whole lot of people involved in the governing process. Christ will function as king, but he'll have a whole lot of governors and regents and people that will be working underneath judges and a whole lot of, your apostles are going to be over the 12 tribes of Israel. They're going to be involved in the judgment process, judging, the nations. So it's going to be a lot, and we're going to study all of that a little later on. Contrast the resurrection body of the saved with the resurrection body of the lost we just did. Why does the doctrine of eternal punishment constitute an impelling motive for preaching the gospel to every creature? Why does the doctrine of eternal punishment constitute an impelling motive for preaching the gospel to every creature?
That's forever.
That's forever. That's not a thousand. There's no getting out of it. It's going to be forever, 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 forever. A million, billion, trillion, quadrillion, quintillion, sextillion, sextillion. It's going to be a long time. It's going to be forever and forever. So if you thought about it that and really focus on it a while, I think that you'll have a little brokenness. Okay. Time is about gone, part one. We can save our children false, or we can, any questions on it? Sister Mary Ann, you got your answers, I hope that.
I'm getting it. I'm beginning to get it, but I still got a lot of stuff, but it's extremely
right.
Interesting.
Okay.
It's very involved because, a lot of focus and attention is, although we had a book we read and, and we did a series on it a while back, it's not something that you hear every day. And there's a complexity about it, and you have to just read it and read it and sort through and think about it and pray about it and all. Because it's not for me, it's not one of those things that like, it's like a lot of things just come like that.
Okay.
This is more intense.
Right. Okay, well, let me just ask you all this question. How do you feel about how important you feel it is to understand the coming of the Lord with the saints, and the coming of the Lord for the saints, and the coming of the Lord with the saints? How important do you feel understanding the distinction between those two beings?
If you don't understand the distinction, you can't
really
understand the
end. Right. Okay, see, tonight when you asked me about those Old Testament saints, see, I had to explain that in relationship to a comment on the rapture and the coming of the Lord for the saints, and the coming of the Lord with the saints. Because I, on the end, I said that the Old Testament saints are going to be a part of that army. In Revelation, we read about Christ coming back. And so if they're going to be a part of that army, then they're going to have to be what resurrected at the close of the what tribulation before Christ comes back to the earth with the saints. So it's kind of important for you to really understand the difference between the rapture and on one of those questions in your deal, we asked about the only ones that had a revelation of the coming of the Lord for the saints was Enoch and Paul. Where did y'all put for that? That was one of them. All right, the only ones that had a revelation of the rapture was Enoch and the Apostle Paul. True or false? All right, sister Denise, you're right. It was. But I didn't try to trick you. I just wanted to make sure that you read it thoroughly. Mm-hmm. Now, because I want you to understand this well, I devised these questions that I just handed out. These ones that you have to fill in the blank. And I love these here, 21 through 30. Now look at that, 21 through 30. I love those. You're going to have to be able to see there are a lot of scriptures that relate to the end and in terms of Christ coming to the earth. You have to determine whether the rapture or the trip will be the revelation. I mean, understand what I'm speaking about when I say rapture or revelation. I'm going to understand the two R's. Raise your hand if you understand the two R's. All right. If you understand the two R's, then you understand a whole lot more than most saints understand. Okay. And you understand the two R's in respect to the tribulation. I'm going to understand the two R's in respect to the tribulation. Well, it's the four after. All right. Now, next week, we'll let y'all break down. How many want to break down? And maybe you won't be ashamed to talk in class in a little small group. Okay, I got some volunteers for next week. All right. I got some volunteers. Brother Wayne and Sister Wayne, that's one. Y'all have the question coming. And we're going to try to get all the saints out next week. Because, you know, they need copies of this because they're not coming, they need to still work these out. Okay, the second coordinator, Sister Pearl, you want to coordinate? Pick your pastor. Who want to?
Anyone who wants to help,
I'll help. Okay, Sister Hill and Sister Pearl.
Thank you.
Okay. Do we need a third one? If we have enough people?
So this means it'll be after Brother and Sister Wayne next week.
No, it will be next week. Now, everybody can break down at the same time next week. And all of y'all questions and all of y'all's misunderstandings, y'all can voice them, and somebody in the class will be able to help.
Okay, now, next week we have the true false and the blank.
Right, true and false and the blank. Hey, we can cover them all?
Probably not.
Okay, well, next week, we need y'all another week to study. And after we get through this, then we'll start talking on rapture readiness.
Give us one more week.
One more week, what, after next week? Two more weeks?
No, just.
Okay. Now, how many have this already? Y'all, some of y'all held these up. I'm going to revise it. How many, the coming of the Lord and the heir for the bride? This 20-some pages, this is real good. Y'all still got this? And I can, so we won't mess with this because this is dealing more with the rapture, explaining the rapture. And along with the rapture, we'll talk a little bit about the tribulation because both of them, the judgment for believers, everybody understand? The judgment, see, after the rapture means that the Lord will take us, come and get us, and take us back with him so we can be judged and that he can, what, that we can become his bride. So we're going to explain that. And while that's happening, then the tribulation period will be what happens down on the earth. So we'll talk about that in this right here. But we don't mess with that right now, right?
Ain't nobody get that right now?
The
bride?
We gave it to you last year.
Oh, I don't have that.
Okay, well, we'll ask it for a Sunday.
Coming as a bride and
so I didn't want to put no more on you than you can bear.
Yeah, the Lord that we did more on us,
so I ain't going to put the tribulation period on you. I ain't going to put the judgment seat of Christ on you. How God will be judging us. All of the things that will come up, the components of judgment.
Well, we need to know that.
Y'all want to know that?
Absolutely.
We're going to walk it through.
Before you dismiss, Sister Pearl.
Okay, Sister Pearl has an announcement. It's about 10 plus minutes. Okay, how many will help me to get the rest of the body here next week? And those that can't come because of conflict, maybe we can do a conference call and put them all on the phone at the same time and go over with them.
Wait.
All right. I shudder sometimes. People not interested in this kind of teaching because this is designed to get you what prepared. The Bible says everybody that has this hope will purify themselves even as he is pure. So this is the teaching that helps you to get on your P's and Q's and to be prepared for the Lord when he comes. Okay. What's the door?
I just have a quick.
Yes, ma'am.
Someone made the statement to me that they don't believe Jesus is coming back anytime soon. Mm-hmm. And they said the reason was because they said, they said, I'm not talking about individuals, I'm mm-hmm. talking about the church body, the church mm-hmm. as a whole.
Mm-hmm.
And we're nowhere near ready to rule and reign.
Okay.
And so he said, that's my reason for believing we're not ready. He said, a lot of times you can't tell the saints
mm-hmm.
from the sinners. Mm-hmm. We're doing the same thing.
Mm-hmm. That just simply means that saints differ and vary from country to country. There are people that's really on fire and a whole lot of people that's going through tribulation now. And they're really suffering. So there's going to be a world church. You know, a lot of saints, the Lord said, because you need a cold and hot, I'll spew you out. God is not waiting for us to
okay.
be prepared. He's not waiting for us like this congregation. He's got people in all congregations that are prepared, that's getting ready, that will be ready when you come. So that's how that works. And most people will be raptured. Most people will be left. That's a nominal Christians, people that or lukewarm, people that just don't meet certain criteria, they will just definitely be left.
So that person may have had, Sister Dorothy, reference to the church in America?
No, well, this was an American.
Mm-hmm.
And he was talking about the church
as a whole,
yes,
in America.
Yes, he was saying that a lot of times you cannot tell mm-hmm. Christians.
Well, now that part is true.
You can't tell mm-hmm. them. He said you just can't.
Well, I think that people that really are true Christians, I believe that they will, the Bible says, that him that have ears to hear, they have what? Hear what the Spirit of the Lord says. See, those people that Christ, that's the reason why if you read Revelations 1, 2, 3, you can see how the Lord works that. This is the way he works it. In all of those churches, he commends them for the good they've done, and some of them he didn't find anything wrong. But most of them, he found something wrong. He told them what to get right. He said, if you don't get it right, repent. He said, repent and get it right. And if you don't, then I'm just going to what? Bring judgment on you. So that's the way he operates it. He said, but in every one of those churches, and that represents all of the church ages of all times, there were true people that were really living for God. In every single church age, there were just a nucleus of people that were really what? Measured up to God's standard. And those are the people that, he said, those that overcome, I will cause you to what? Be pillars in the temple. Those that overcome, I will cause you to what? To rule and to reign. He went on down the line. He said, those that overcome. So it's going to be a little remnant in every church age that's going to what? Overcome. And that's going to be ready. God is dealing with them even now. Just like some of y'all, God is dealing with you. Just like me. I said, man, I got to really, there's some things I know that I got to do. But this teaching here is just causing me to think different about everything. Mm-hmm. Wasting time and goofing off and half sincere.
If it's like, mm-hmm. Sister Dorothy, I was listening to that.
Mm-hmm.
That is a point.
Mm-hmm.
That in terms of when you look at the church overall, that the church is not ready.
Mm-hmm.
And he said he's coming back from church.
Mm-hmm.
But I think I heard him say he couldn't come now because the church is not ready.
Mm-hmm.
The church could be ready just like that.
Mm-hmm.
The real church.
Those
can be ready.
Those people can all.
Right, mm-hmm. right.
Yeah, and the church, the coming of the Lord has nothing to do with, I know the Bible says he's coming back for a church without spot or wrinkle, but you're going to have people without spot or wrinkle in all churches, remnant, few here, few there. You're going to have that, so that's already in place. There's nothing that has to be fulfilled to hinder Jesus from coming back right now. But all of the signs that we read about, so you don't look at just one thing, the church is not ready. You look at all of the signs. And when you think about the kings of the East are supposed to come across the Euphrates, and they just got that dam with all those levers and things in place where they can just push a button and the whole river will dry up, permitting 200 million soldiers from the East to come back. That's already done. So I don't know of too many things that's not in place. And everything that's not fulfilled is going to be fulfilled the last 7 years, and but we're supposed to be gone before the last 7 years. That's the problem. So the Antichrist got to be what? Revealed and make peace with the what? Israel and all of that. Okay, so when we leave, yeah, he's going to what? He's going to come to the scene. Okay,
so when we're raptured, will we be judged then?
From all indications, the judgment seat of Christ is going to be the main focus at the beginning of the 7-year period. There's going to be a marriage to the bride, a wedding, and all of that will take place while we are away with the Lord in the air. We are there to be judged, but we are also there to escape the tribulation that's supposed to be happening during that 7-year period.
We'll be in heaven?
Yeah, we'll be in heaven. Mm-hmm. I go prepare a place for you. That's that New Jerusalem. that we'll be able to go back and forth from and to the earth during 1,000 years. That's where we'll have it over the saints that will be in the kingdom in their physical body. They won't be able to go back and forth because we won't be limited by time and space and power of locomotion.
Well, that's a big one.
Appear and disappear.
The temple that they rebuilt before the tribulation or in the tribulation?
I'm going to share that soon, before or during the tribulation. There's nothing that has to be fulfilled before Jesus comes. First time, there you go. So that might show some, get some language. Okay, I'm ready to just pray, close in prayer. Father, tonight, lead and direct us, O Lord, through all of this teaching, awaken us so that we won't be overcharged with serpentine, so that the cares of this life and the things of the deceitfulness of riches and all of these things will come on us and catch us unaware. He said for us to watch and pray, for we know not the day or the hour that the Lord comes. Father, today we're just not praying just that we might escape and go into rapture, but we want to be concerned about all of those that will be possibly will be left unless somebody share with them, unless somebody is able to talk to them and to minister to them. Father, help us, Lord, to prepare for that dreadful day. Lord, help us to understand that everything that we're working hard for and all of the assets and things that we've got, we're going to leave it all behind. We brought nothing here, and we're going to take nothing away. So that means that we don't want to get overly concerned about things, about all of the big dreams that we have and all of the assets and material things that we have. All of this will be left behind. So that should cause us to be sober and come to our senses and help us to understand only what we do for Christ will last. Father, we give you praise and the glory tonight. Lord, in terms of consecration, help us, Lord, to think in terms of coming together with saints, sharing the end time teaching, praying together with brokenness and stirring each other up into righteousness so that we will be at our best and we won't be ashamed at his coming. Now unto him that is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before his presence with exceeding great joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory, honor, dominion, and power, both now and forever. Everybody say it together. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.